We are back. My next guest tonight, please welcome a very funny guy, Artie Lang.
Our next guest is one of the funniest guys there is. He eats devil dogs for breakfast and cigarettes for lunch. Hey, ladies, here he is, Artie Lang.
We are joined right now by a hilarious comedian. His latest project, the Artie Quitter podcast, is available through artiequitter.com. Please give a warm welcome to a good friend of the show. Here's Artie Lang, ladies and gentlemen.
Our next guest is a regular on the Howard Stern radio program and the author of this New York Times bestseller entitled Too Fat to Fish. Here he is, the very funny Artie Lang. Oh, Artie.
It always makes me laugh when I see Artie Lang on stage. Knowing I'm going to outlive him.
A Jack Daniel's swilling pizza eating, dog hating, whore using, cocaine abusing, hairy back, big belly blowhard from New Jersey. The fat little bastard known as Artie Lang.
We're recording.
All right.
I had a Diet Coke.
Joe mistimed his caffeine. That's what we'll lead off with. Joe Matarese is here and he mistimed his caffeine. That's what Joe just said to me. He missed time. His caffeine. What does that mean? So you're taking Adderall. So
no
you
Adderall.
Seem down.
No, I'm not down.
Well, you seem very, like, melancholy.
Well,
last time you were shot out of a cannon.
I got here at 9. Dan said 8:30.
Well, you're going to have to. listen.
And now it's 11.
You're going to have to understand. I'm not. This is not Jessica Lang. It's Artie Lang.
I can't get here late enough.
Joe has a. Joe has a very, very powerful manager, Rick Dorfman. And Rick's advice to him is not to do podcasts. but we got to the bottom.
In L.A.
In L.A. Because he said, we have a lot of meetings, and I want you to be energetic.
And what's your take on
that? Well, I've been to meetings with Rick, and I would suggest to him, you should say to him, do a lot of podcasts so he's not energetic in the meeting.
He gets too energetic.
Anything that will make Rick talk less in the meeting, I think you should try. he brings up a lot of great stuff. Now, but that's exciting, though.
I have a dinner with Rick on Thursday to map out the show.
Is that a big dinner?
To map out the show.
I don't know what that's like. I've blown off every dinner. Now, but but he didn't be big pod. You're going to do Mark Maron, right?
I'm doing Maron on Monday, and then I'm doing Jay Mohr one of those days.
Mark Maron and Jay Mohr are two of the biggest podcasts. I mean, you can make an argument you shouldn't be doing this.
Shouldn't be here right now.
Well, no one really listens to this.
Joe, you seem down.
You do seem down.
Is it because you're at my podcast?
No, believe me. That could be. I'm down because I'm at my podcast.
I don't want you to take down as just tired.
Believe me, I forgot about it.
Okay, good.
I have a
different schedule.
Last time you were shot out of a cannon.
I could be. If I had a, I should have a cup of coffee.
Should we in there and leave the room and
You know what else? I had two slices from that Uptown Pizza when I got here.
Not
too.
Good. It's like lead.
I think that took me down.
It's like lead. It's like Joe Pesci says in Goodfellas. This stuff is good, but it's like lead in your stomach. It's like a fucking baboon, you know?
It was very cheesy.
That's what it does.
It was good, though.
Try the Ragout White Pie.
Oof.
But anyway, so Joe's here. I asked Joe, the big story is this gorilla in Cincinnati. A kid fell into a gorilla enclosure at a zoo in Cincinnati. And basically the kid was like its plaything for a three-year-old kid. And when I saw the kid was black, I said, oh, my God, I've got to go on Twitter because holy Christ. Black kid falling in a gorilla enclosure. Twitter, here come the racist jokes.
He thought it was being adopted.
Well, I mean, you know, the best one was the father of the black child wasn't mm-hmm. there. They had the first thing they tried is this special gorilla call to try to lure the gorilla out of it. And two females went, but the gorilla that had the kid didn't come. It didn't work. So one of the people on Twitter, he was trying to construct a joke, and I figured out what it was. And basically, the guy's joke was that the father went when the call came. That's why he wasn't there.
That's funny.
Yeah.
God.
Again, one of my followers thought of that. Not me.
Dude, that was just terrifying to watch.
So he thought that the father was when the father heard the gorilla call, he went to wherever the call was, so he wasn't there. The gorilla didn't go. And listen, terrifying is not even the word. It's you. And the gorilla is treating that thing like King Kong does Fay Wray or Naomi Watts. Like when the thing tries to get away, he pulls it back. And it's very odd. And at one point, what they don't put talk about on the air, at one point in the second part of the video, the kid tries to get away. He grabs the kid. He puts the kid, stands the kid up, and faces the kid away from him. And then starts to adjust the kid's shorts. Like he's going to take the kid's shorts. And at this point, it looks like an R. Kelly sex video. Did you guys ever see that one R. Kelly video? Me and Howard were watching it, and we were trying to decide whether or not it was real. Someone sent this is years ago, like 2005 when it was going around, and Howard had the funniest line. He goes, I don't know if that's R. Kelly, but that guy knows how to make love to a woman. I don't know. I think it ended up being R. Kelly, but he's got this broad, this black chick with this ass that is unbelievable. And it is like a big ass, but a perfect ass. And it's jiggling around in the right way. And he's fucking smacking at it, licking it, like preparing it like a pizza, like a guy making a pizza. like a Luigi's, and he would throw it up in the air sometimes, catch it. Yeah, it was tonguing it, fucking it. I've never seen someone that. Like, I assume, like, when you make love to a woman, it does not look like this. This was an expert fucker. This guy knew how to fuck. And this chick was, yeah, baby. All the stereotypical shit. Like the stuff Pam Anderson says in that video. The dumb shit that comes out of Tommy Lee and Pam Anderson's mouth in that video. It's so fucking sexy. When a hot chick does something illegal, like she's rolling that joint, oh my God, I couldn't have jerked off harder. And she doesn't know how to roll the joint because she's so stupid. I love how stupid she is.
Well, I remember, this is a weird, you just clicked the memory. You know the Sklar brothers. I don't know if people know who the Sklar brothers are.
You're going to change?
No, but this has
to do with... switching the subject from the Pam Anderson video to the Sklar brothers?
This has to do with the Pam Anderson video, though. I remember them...
I feel like a judge. Okay, subject to fucking connection. I'll let you go with this, Joe.
I remember them releasing some sort of video where they did something with the Pam Anderson video.
Edited them in or something?
They did some comedy bit, and I can't remember what it was. And they tried to, like, circulate it around the business. You know, remember, like, how
Dan, we could edit this, right?
Yeah. Who were the guys, Matt Stone and whatever, the guy that did South Park?
Right.
Remember how South Park became a show? They released a little short within the industry?
Right.
Where it was Jesus Christ
Brian Bortano.
Yeah, that whole video. I think the Sklar brothers did something with the Pam Anderson video. Where they did some sort of comedic bit, and I can't fucking remember what it was.
Can we start the show over?
Well, much like R. Kelly did to that girl, Joe just pissed on your bit.
No.
I was thinking you might have remembered it. I don't know why.
Why would you say that? What am I, Sklar like Brothers fucking guy?
No, like making fun of it, because it didn't work. It didn't work.
Well, if I had a list of the Sklar Brothers shit we could make fun of, that so you want to wait? So you can't be more specific. A Sklar Brothers bit that didn't work.
No.
Okay.
So back to rolling the joint and it being very sexy.
Thank you. Well, all right.
And I remember the blowjob.
Got to ramp
the blowjob in the car was pretty
right.
Good.
No, my point was it was well taken before.
Was she the first celeb to release a sex video?
No.
Who did it before her?
I think the Sklar Brothers. I wish you had video of Joe fucking the audience right now.
Yes.
My God. I mean, I was about to be so funny. I mean, if you're a fan of mine, you have no idea the take I had on that. But it's real. I feel like we're watching like a big lark balloon.
Joe, you seem slowly down on you.
Well, now I do. Do you want to, why don't we start this? Listen, we'll do this. Dan and I will leave. You do whatever you have to do to get ramped up. Snort the Adderall, do whatever you want. We won't be here. Mm-hmm. And we'll come back in like 20 minutes. And Dan, we'll get a slice of pizza. the gorilla video with that kid is as horrifying as you could possibly imagine. And the big debate, this is why people are morons. The big debate on every news show today is, was the zoo correct in shooting the gorilla dead. What? How is that a debate? He might have started to fuck the kid. Another guy testified that he saw the same gorilla crush a coconut with one hand in like seconds, which he could have done to this poor kid's head. And, you know, what's the debate? If you shoot the thing with a tranquilizer gun, which people were talking about, it takes 10 minutes. You shoot the thing with a dart 10 minutes before it goes down. So you're just agitating the thing. You know how long 10 minutes is for a parent to watch that? You can't take a chance. You got to shoot the fucking thing. Dead. Gone. Bye. Headshot. You're out. Done. I mean, come on. And, you know, quite frankly, they're talking about whether or not the parents are negligent. How does a three-year-old kid get in that fucking... doesn't a zoo test that shit? Like, you know, okay, let's try every scenario. There's no way a kid can get in there, right? Every scenario. The thing, supposedly the kid had to go through a bunch of brush, bushes, then get to a fence, jump the fence, somehow get wiggle his way into a pipe and go down into the moat. Big moat. All right? I just found out why they have a lawsuit, the family. The zoo was negligent in the fact they probably only tested it with a white kid. You know, you got to make sure a black kid can't get down there. Because a white kid probably can't, but that black kid, Jimmy the Greek, extra bone in his ankle. Remember the Jimmy the Greek thing? What would happen is they take the big black buck, that's what happened. The kid was breeded by two big black bucks. And that kid, of course a black kid can get over the fence. Those little white Cincinnati kids, they got no soul. No way that kid's getting in there.
I think the kid just saw Shawshank Redemption. got through the sewage pipe.
Well, yeah, well, that's kind of what it was like. Tim Robbins. Andy Dufresne dragged his way through 2 miles of the foulest, disgusting shit to his way to freedom. Andy Dufresne. By the way, that's a very weak premise when you watch that. It was a rock hammer. A rock hammer he got in 1946.
Took him 30 years.
30 years, two-mile tunnel. And in the meantime, he sculpted the best, most articulate chess set you ever saw in your life. I had time to dig a 2-mile tunnel and make all the chess pieces look like every knight from King Arthur's court.
Do they have video of the kill? They don't have that.
They probably do, but they're not showing it.
I gotta see.
Thought the video I saw was, you know, they always stopped it at the ape touching the kid's shorts. It looks like he's about to fuck that kid.
That thing, if you killed the ape incorrectly, it would just die and fall right on the kid and kill it.
Well, I think
that's how big the ape is.
Yeah, well, exactly. You're talking about a 17-year-old silverback gorilla. They're killers. That's what they do.
How long do they live normally? Like, did they really cut its life?
18 years.
They live to their 18.
No, they live a long time.
Do they really?
Yeah. And some of the other kids on Twitter were so stupid. You could tell they were brought up by Disney. One kid said if the kid was white, the gorilla would have looked at it as a god and never touched the kid. And I found out after talking to that kid for 20 minutes, he was dead serious. No. And his point was in King Kong, the whole premise of the movie is that the woman's white, and that's why he doesn't kill it. If it's a black chick, he just like fondles the tits and bites the head off. No movie. And I said, you know, King Kong's not based on a true story. most of what follows is true. Very, very disgusting, offensive shit on Twitter, and I'm not for. There's no way the father went for the gorilla call. There's no way. No way that happened. But I made the observation that it looked like an R. Kelly sex video when he grabbed the kid's shorts. Joe, your thoughts on that?
I'm curious. Well, there's no way they could figure it out because now they're seeing if they're going to figure out if they're going to press charges on the parents.
They're not. They just said no. Well, you know, it's funny. Again, as a comedian, you did not see that video till just now. How is that possible?
Oh, I'm
doing a lot of yard work at my house already. You got to see
But you were at the gym.
You got to see the mulch.
I saw a Periscope this morning for 15 minutes. You're at the gym. How do you not see it at the gym on the TV?
I didn't watch the TVs at the gym.
Yeah, well, I can see that, but you don't have to. I'm saying it's in the newspaper. It's do you look at news at all? Probably not. Then. There's no way you can look at news and not see this.
No, I didn't have the TV on once today.
Right. Do you ever to write material? Do you ever look at the? You don't.
Yeah,
look at,
yeah. I watch the news, but I did not. Usually, I listen to the news a lot on rides, but I.
This is something you got to see, though. It's extraordinary.
Yeah. No, I didn't.
What, so you don't
usually if the it's funny that my wife must have missed it too, because she usually would have came home and been like, did you see the fucking eight video? Holy right. Shit, did you see that?
Yeah.
No, I didn't see it. Oh, you gotta watch this.
But my mother shouldn't watch that. A mother watching that, like, they immediately put themselves in that position.
I didn't get one text of somebody saying, did you see it? Nothing.
Yeah. Well, I know you're not gonna say yes.
I don't mean,
that's why I don't mean
by you guys. No. I mean by anybody, my friends, family, nobody.
Well, you're from Philly, right? one of the eagles wasn't in the video. There was no eagle angle to the story. I told Danny to make you watch him before the podcast because I knew, you had to see it, and I knew you didn't see it.
I read the story, too.
I never met two more uninformed comedians than Chris Cotton and Gino Bisconti. And every time I'd bring it up, Gino would argue with me that, no, my fans, don't like that. Don't like the topical shit. I said, what are they? All he talks about is the Chargers secondary. I said, so you're really narrowing down your fan base. So rather than like try to make everyone who watches the news laugh, you're narrowing it down to people who know if the Chargers secondary needs a big trade. Gino gets very bitter when I bring it up.
Some comedians do not really talk about the news and purposely don't. And you definitely
we can't name
do.
No one can name them.
Brian Regan doesn't do news stories.
Yes, he does. Of course he does. A lot of his shit is based on what happened to the news.
Tell me one.
The new traffic laws that came out. Well, I mean, he does it for a long time. But, a lot of his shit, in other words, what you're saying is it's right and wrong, because he'll take a news story, but then he'll do a bit that's great and do that for like a year. But it's based on a news story. You know, like the one great bit he does about horses. There was a story in California about the people transporting horses on the highway, mm-hmm. and about how he was in the back of a horse. And he talks about, like, you know, the driver's attitude. It's just so fucking hilarious. But it's based on a story that came out in the LA Times. Another one is the law just come out, the cable laws, and the telephone company or the cable company. They could switch on your cable. They don't have to send the guy out. It was like front page news. So people lost their jobs. You could just, like, you call the cable company, and the cable company, when they're ready to do it, when you pay your bill, they could just switch it on from the office.
Right.
So a guy didn't have to come out. So he's got that fucking hilarious bit, the punchline.
I don't know if, well, I don't want to disagree with you. It's your podcast.
Go ahead. No, that's why you should. You shouldn't disagree. Well, it's a news story.
I don't know if I don't know if either of those bits. Because I've heard Regan do those bits.
Right.
He doesn't reference they were off of a news.
But that's
story.
Where he gets them from, though.
But no, I mean, if you're talking,
he makes it up.
No, you're talking about them switching the cable on from
Joe,
there.
Joe,
that's just
Joe,
a fact.
Joe Regan brought no. It was a fact that he that got in his head because he read in the paper that people lost jobs.
No, we got to find the bit, because I think the bit is more of him talking to the cable company on the phone. Can you turn my cable on? They're like, yeah, it's on now. We just turned it on. That's how the bit goes.
The bit goes. we don't have to send somebody out. There's a switch that we just have to.
Yeah, yeah. But he's on the phone with them.
Yeah. Well, of course, he's not yelling out the window. Yeah.
But it's not like
he
read it in
the news. He goes, can you see the switch?
But you don't think that bit came off of him actually talking to the cable company?
I think it came off of reading the story. You think he was? You think that actually happened? Him talking? You think that happened? Him talking to the people?
Anyone who's gotten the cable turned on has had that happen.
Okay,
when you moved somewhere and you call you get your cable, they tell you it's working now. Like it sounds like an observation.
I'll give you the Brian Regan argument. I'll give it to you.
I agree. I think the news is super important, and I actually agree with you. When you give me shit about not being well read enough. I agree with you every time.
The point is that you're not smart.
Gino's an idiot where he'd be like, my fans. That's ridiculous.
I was trying to hold back on saying he's an idiot. But, no, but the point is, yeah, someone like you can write 2 million. Think of the jokes you can write from just watching that video. I think you're, in other words, I think you're missing out on a lot of funny shit. That's all.
Yeah.
Because you're very good at observing stuff.
Well, you know what? It reminds me of a bit I did up fucking like 15 years ago about, and this might have been a news story, where a woman thought that her babysitter was hurting her kid.
Right.
So she set up a camera to tape the babysitter. And I said, if you're thinking your fucking kid might be getting beat up by your babysitter, how about getting a new babysitter?
Right.
Like, you don't set the camera up. Like, that's what made me think of that when I was watching that video. Is there's a fucking woman just, like, it's just sad that that's our first instinct now, is get the camera.
See, so, so imagine if, you know, you, in the last 15 years, watched another video.
But isn't it sad that, like,
in 15 years, if you watch the news, I think you're missing out on a lot of the great jokes like it.
I agree with you, though.
You know, again, the problem is a lot of the racial shit does come from these some of these guerrilla videos. These Twitter guys think that they should be comedians because they think these racist jokes are so funny. I'm like, you're not going to make it. That's not going to, you know, saying the guy went for the gorilla call is not going to get you a spot at, you know, you got to come up with something different. Well, the other.
What do you got on it? Anything?
Well, you heard the R. Kelly things. Well, I have
R. Kelly.
And, of course, the gorilla call thing was secretly mine. I blamed it on Twitter. I could do that in Philly and Boston easily at midnight. No, I mean, this was a great thing until the Sklar thing really took it down. I mean, I had connections with the other stuff.
I still want to know the original sex video that came out.
Well, bring that up on the Marriage podcast. No, save that for one of the meetings with Rick. Save that for the dinner.
The dinner.
Yeah. Where are you guys having dinner?
What's good is actually he lives in Westchester and so do I.
Are you going to live in New York?
Yeah. Well, the dinner. Well, we're going to have, because the meetings start as soon as we get out there.
This is real exciting. So you got is it for a sitcom?
Yeah.
That's great. You know, with so many options now with so many news channels, Netflix. And
what's the proper amount of meetings that a manager should have for you?
I don't know. Depends on the idea, I guess. It depends on the manager.
Back in the day, the Artie Lang development deal every fucking year days.
There were only four networks. It was so simple.
How many meetings would you have?
Four.
You just have four.
Yeah. UPN would just be there to get the price up. Every year, the same UPN meeting would happen. You're not going to just use us to get the price up. No, of course not. Peter Principato would go, that's exactly what we're doing.
But there were production deals, too. You could go around the networks.
By the third year, I let Pete go on those blames. But, you know, it's so funny. Pete and I would have dinner sometimes, or lunch right before one of the meetings, and I would drop Russian dressing on my shirt. And he would go, that's fine. You shouldn't be eccentric. You're the talent. It's fine. And I go, great. Then an hour later, as we're leaving, he would drop Russian dressing on his shirt. And I go, well, you're the manager. How's that going to work? I guess we'll both go in with Russian dressing on our shirt.
No, my favorite. Sorry.
Go ahead.
My favorite was when you do the Principato saying the "I've been good" story. Is my favorite.
You know, people made T-shirts up with that. It's so great that on the internet, some fan of the show made up a T-shirt that has that whole thing on it.
What?
I don't know how you fit it in. I've been good all week. I'm going to go ahead and do it. I'm going to get the pancakes. That's what it says on the T-shirt.
I love it.
You can probably find that.
Gotta have that T-shirt.
I think Artie Fan Clips or Artie Fan Nation or what it was. By the way, they started a wrap-up show for this show.
Really?
Yeah. Their debut episode was 2 days ago. That's what somebody said on Twitter. I don't know. Twitter is crazy.
It's funny. I just got a new car that has SiriusXM in it for 3 months for free, and all of a sudden I'm listening to all the old Stern episodes, and it's fucking good.
It's amazing how it's so brilliant of him to own those tapes, man. It helps my career now. It sells stand-up tickets that there's still shows that I was on.
I know. And it's amazing.
It's like I'm on the radio every morning still. And, you know, the problem is I don't listen to them, and the people at the stand-up shows do, and they yell it out like I just did it that morning. Like, you're yelling out something that happened hour two of the show, 2006. You know how much heroin I've done since then? What are you yelling out? Do Sal's emotional friend voice. I don't even remember what the fuck you're talking about. You do it. What did I sound like? You yell it out. And people say, oh, it's like being on a syndicated sitcom. I'm like, yeah, if one guy gets paid.
Exactly. It's really set up well.
Now, talk about brilliant. That is like that contract that Howard had. The first series contract should be in the Smithsonian framed as far as the contract any creative person ever wants. It basically gave him the company. They said, here, you're now not only part owner, you're a majority owner. Now you're our boss. And there's bonuses that are ridiculous. There's no way you can't hit these bonuses. I'll give you, again, this is public knowledge, so it's not betraying anybody. The contract came out, it's like $100 million a year. So that comes out. And I do believe that he had to pay all of us out of that. Based on what I made and everybody else, you're talking about, I figure he's got to lose about $5 million in overhead to build the studio, because the studio was insane. Say, all of that he had to pay for out of the $100 million. So let's figure it's $95 million a year. Now, there were bonuses written into that. And they were public bonuses. They were, headlines in the New York Post every time he came out. On top of the $100 million, the first bonus was if we hit 300,000 subscribers, because when we signed up, there were only like 10,000 people. If he hit 300,000 subscribers, which was so doable, like, they thought that was a challenge. We ended up with 10 million by the end of the first year, I think. He got another bonus, and it was stock options. Not options, or stocks. They just gave him stocks that he immediately could liquidate. It came out to in cash like $200 million extra on top of the thing.
Just random stocks.
Well, just stocks in the company that he immediately liquidated. Like you didn't even, just buy. I'm not even going to just keep them. I'm turning them into money. Or it was just cash because there was two of them. The second bonus might have been the stocks. The point is the first one that I'm talking about was worth $200 million on top of the contract. So we're in a creative meeting every Thursday, and Gary is reading the New York Post. And we did the show. We're all kind of fried, and we're tired. And Gary says out loud in the meeting, I'm sitting next to Howard. I would sit next to Howard right here. Freddie would sit here, and then Gary, and all the interns would come in. That was the cool thing about the show. Howard let the interns pitch shit, which was great. And Gary reads the Post, goes, hey, look, this is cool. We hit 300,000 subscribers today. And I go, really? That's great. And Howard was kind of sleeping. He looked up and said, what'd you say? And Gary said, we hit 300,000 subscribers. And Howard said, oh, that's cool. He just kind of made a thing with his eyes and he looked down. And we had the meeting and blah, blah, blah. Next day in the financial section of the Post, it says, because Sirius hits 300,000 subscribers, Stern gets $200 million.
Oh, God.
Okay. So I realized that I saw a human being's reaction when he found that he was $200 million richer. And it was basically this. What'd you say? We hit 300,000. Oh, really? Okay, great. That's how he reacted to being $200 million.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. And then, like, 5 months later, there was another one that gave him 34 million shares of stock. Oh, the stock was worth about $5 a share. He got 34 million shares. Buckwall got 3 million. And I'm not saying this. I'm not a bitter asshole. I'm in awe of it. He deserves it. You got to remember, Howard was the guy. Howard's not some rich kid who got everything handed to him. Howard's the direct opposite of that. It's pure talent. It's pure ability on the radio. He was a guy who was making $96 a week in a hotel room in Detroit. Detroit! His first wife was iffy. They separated a bit. It was a bad time for him. She couldn't make the trip. He was afraid he was going to lose her. So he didn't have a kid yet. So he's alone in the world. Think about that. He didn't have a lot of friends back then, blah, blah, blah. It's all the radio in him. So he would sit on the edge of the bed and do his laundry in a motel room in Detroit, $96 a week. And that's what he did. So I'm not mad. I'm not bitter. You know, I'm the last guy to be bitter. I came in when the gravy train was already rolling. That show was already a legendary show when I got there. All I could do was fuck it up. So I'm saying this because I'm in awe of it. Also because it's public record. It was in the newspaper. 34 million. So basically, that's what happened. He didn't wait for that. He sold those. So 34 million times $5. What is that? That's another $300 million. So that came, I think, when we hit 750,000 people, which was like a week later. And no one could tell him what to do. We had our own wing. The president of the company wasn't allowed to use our bathroom. It was so great.
The guy that deserves a lot of money is there has to be somebody who worked for Howard that knew how to come up with the numbers that he thinks he can hit.
Tom Buchwald.
Yeah.
That guy's a fucking genius. And the fact that Howard hooked up with a guy like that early in his career and Howard recognized that this is the guy to go with. You know, like Joe and I can relate to this as comics. You know, people always say, Joe's probably got the same story. I think he does from talking to him. But, you know, when I came up, everybody in my family, you know, nobody's in show business in my family. I'm doing this all on my own, man. I don't have anybody to give me advice. Like, I could give somebody advice now. But I didn't have anybody like that in my world. I doubt Joe did. Like, nobody in my family was a comedian. Nobody was a singer. Nobody dealt with agents. They were construction workers. So I'm the first guy to do this. I had no friends like that. So I'm trying to not step on landmines. That's what I'm trying to do. And every successful comedian had a manager, an agent, and a lawyer, like David Spade, Norm Macdonald. So I said, I guess that's what I got to do. If I get a chance to have a manager, I'll get one. Agent, the same thing. So the people in my family are smart people. They look at it logically and go, what's a manager do that an agent doesn't? And I'm like, to this day, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what the fuck they know. One guy tells you to wear a different sweater on Conan. Another guy gets you a deal. I don't know what the fuck they do. Howard would hear that and he would go, that's the most retarded thing I've ever heard in my life. He goes, I've always had one guy, Don Buchwald, and a lawyer that I don't give a percentage to. I pay him by the hour. And Don gets 10%.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Don gets 10%. Don has lawyers that work for him. I go, so does William Morris. I was at William Morris at the time. And he goes, what about their lawyers? I'm like, you're right. What about them? A lot of times their lawyers. See, the problem is, like, my first show was Mad TV. Quincy Jones was my boss. Quincy Jones was rep by William Morris. So we're both at William Morris. So why wouldn't I use the William Morris lawyers? Who's there? Who are they going to make happy? There's a conflict of interest. So I got my own lawyer. And Howard's like, that's a flawed business. So Howard's only made all that money, and he was smart enough to hire the right guy in the beginning. One guy gets 10%. Manager from me and Joe are in a business where a manager gets 10, a lawyer gets 5, an agent gets 10. Sometimes a manager got 15 in the early days. And 25% of your income is gone before of the gross amount, of the gross amount. Not off the top. Your manager doesn't take 10% off your fucking income after the fucking agent takes 10. No, they take 10 points off the top. It's the most retarded thing ever.
And last time I was on, we were talking about how, and these guys nowadays, because things have changed, where right. comedians are making their own projects and getting right. their own funding.
Right.
Now, if you're not fucking smart enough, they'll right. try to take 10% of the fucking full yeah. amount before you pay off the people that gave you the money to make the project.
It's unbelievable. Exactly.
And you're like, what?
Right.
This is what they actually said to me, my old managers. They go, well, we have two other clients that are letting us do that. And then finally you get to the level where you can look at your manager right in the face and go, they're fucking stupid.
Exactly.
They're too stupid. I'm not stupid.
And we're older now. So we're getting to the point where
we just don't care.
Right. I want to know what you're doing for this money. You got to show me what you're doing. Because it's changing, man. This new technology, like, I'm sitting on my couch right now. Like, I have a lot of overhead, you know, so in my life, because, you know, I started making money, so, you know, I pay for a lot of different things. So I got to make more money. But, you know, I mean, look, I'm not going to lie to you. I make, you know, close to a couple hundred grand off this podcast a year. You know, I'm sitting on my couch right now. and I don't need anybody to do this. As long as I'm confident I can be funny, I don't need any of these motherfuckers anymore. Anthony Kumi is an example of that. You know, I'm not, you know, Anthony, I think, had a bad night there with the Twitter. We all have. I mean, I can't condone what he said, but, you know, it doesn't mean he's a bad guy. He had a shitty night. I'm not condoning all that, you know, what he did there. But as an example, a company like Sirius used to have all power over a guy like him. Like, we're going to fire you. And Anthony said, okay. And now, because of technology, he's making way more money than he could ever make in Sirius, ever. Because, you know, to his fans, he's funny. That's all he needs to do is deliver.
Well, it's like I was listening to Sebastian Maniscalco's podcast a couple days ago, and he finds out that his NBC pilot doesn't get picked up.
Right.
And you listen to him, and he's like, eh, all right.
Gives a shit.
He's a second of down and knew that he had 15 gigs coming up where he's making $50,000 to $100,000 a piece.
Well, that's what I mean. Yeah, it's like this podcast is like a base salary. I do stand up still, and I, you know, it's we don't need you anymore. In a lot of ways, I don't want to be. I look at the NBC network shows. I don't want to be on any of them.
That's the thing too.
I hate. They're all terrible. Like, I'm about to shoot a show, you know, somehow I'm on an HBO show right now. The Judd Apatow is, I had my first rehearsal today. It's fucking, it's so much fun. But it's HBO. You know, the whole show is, the first three episodes is basically like a buddy comedy. We and this kid Pete Holmes, and we're going back and forth. And in rehearsal today, they let us improv, and you can curse, say what you want. Why would I want to go back to something on CBS? You know,
well, the only isn't a lot of the reason is the multi-camera thing is a short day.
It's a short
when you're filming an episode of this HBO show, you're probably what are you? Is your call time at 5 a.m. and you're
it's like a movie,
and you're home at midnight.
It's like a movie. It is. But listen, I was a supporting character on a sitcom before camera thing when I was on the Norm Show. That was like retired work. I was making about $800,000 a year and off just that. And I didn't bring anything to work. I didn't have a piece of paper. I would go there and they'd tell me jokes I had to say. I'd learn them at, like 10 minutes before I sent them. And I would say them. And then I'd go home. There were some shows I had two lines in the whole episode. There was one week I made $40,000 for doing this. I walked in and Norm said, you see that? I go, yeah, are you thinking what I'm thinking? And Norm said, no, I'm not thinking of cheeseburgers. And then I made a funny, mad face and I walked out. That's all. That was my entire role. It was the first scene of the episode. I was done by 7:30 that night. I was drunk on a Sunset Strip by 9. I didn't stay around for goodbyes. The next day, I got a check for $40,000. Yeah.
And it was early, not, you know, it was early in your career, too. It wasn't like, well now you paid your, if you got it now, in your head, you'd be going, yeah, but I've fucking been doing this 30 years. I deserve this easy paycheck.
Well, I'll tell you what it was after. It was after Mad TV. Mad TV was a long day, man. Yeah. That was sketch, an hour of sketch comedy a week. And you had to learn characters. I mean, that was like comedy boot camp. But in a way, I'm glad I did that because there were some weeks where I had to do four different characters, impressions of people. They would give me a tape of Newt Gingrich and say, you're him in this sketch next week. Listen to it. Listen to Newt Gingrich speeches at Congress. And you got like four pages of monologue. That was a lot of work. And that was only $10,000 a week because it wasn't the prime time. The Norm Show was like retired work. It was nothing, but I was getting soft, man. I was L.A. I was becoming very L.A. in a Mercedes convertible, 500 SL. I was a regular at the Beverly Hills Hotel for breakfast. The guys knew me there.
You got up for breakfast?
I'd give the guy a 20. I'd have to be at work at noon. I would time it out. Some days, yeah, for the network read through. I would get there a little early, go to the gym. I would play basketball, sometimes with George Clooney. The whole ER thing guys were there. I played with George Clooney and one of the guys who was like the key grip on fucking ER. George Clooney, a motherfucker in basketball, a little prick. Called a foul every 2 seconds.
He's good?
Very good. Good outside shot.
Really?
Yeah, but like he calls a foul. I'm like, all right, whatever. I guess that was a charge, George. I'm not even kidding. So I'd get there early, and I would time it out. I would make a commercial break on a Stern show back then was like 30 minutes long. because it was on tape in L.A. So I would time it out just after a commercial break. He would sometimes do an hour straight. So I'd drive to work. I had to go. I was living on the Wilshire Corridor in the fucking Beverly Hills. I had to go over Mulholland. It took me 35 minutes to get to work. I'd have breakfast. I'd make sure he was done with the fucking valet guy at the Beverly Hills Hotel knew that he was waiting for the Stern Show to get out of commercial. I'd walk out. He'd go, another couple of minutes, Mr. Lang. And then he'd go, okay. And I would time it out. I heard a whole 35-minute chunk of the Stern Show on my way to work. I had a drive-on pass. I parked 2 feet from the stage. And I went in. And I learned the line, are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Yes.
I like something's wrong. Like people would say, like I would see political people go, we need a change in this country. I'm like, no, we don't. I don't want anything to change. I barely got out of high school. I failed gym. This is my job. My mother thought that I was running guns to Cuba. She didn't know I was getting paid this money.
That was half the reason I was pro-Obama was just that I was able to sell my house when he was president.
Right.
I wanted to get the fuck out of the house that I had. I hated it.
It's a big deal. Right?
I couldn't sell it with the president before him. Then right. He became president, sold my house. I'm in. I love this guy.
Whatever you need.
Who gives a fuck? It's what you need, right?
Yeah. You get selfish when you get older. Yeah, I was with the cause. I was with the people when I was young. Yeah, you know. Well, let's march on the fucking way. March? No, I don't want to pay less. I want to pay less taxes. You get raped. 40% taxes.
I'm somehow not even nervous about these meetings. Like back in the day, dude, I would have been a fucking lunatic.
We're over it.
I'd care what I look like.
Yeah, we're over
it. I would try to get in shape. Yeah. I would like think if my hair looks right.
Yeah.
I don't care.
See, I didn't care back then.
So much better. Well, that's probably why you were nailing them. You didn't care.
No, I was supposed to look like a slob.
No, but I mean, you didn't. You didn't have a get nervous. I care too much. I need this. I used to think I needed it.
Well, I needed the money, that's for sure.
But I needed we all need the money. But when you cannot need them, if you can, I don't know. I'm trying to trick myself.
When you get a few money, it's like you said about Sebastian. When you get a few money, it's a good feeling. See, again, it's also good to have that confidence that you know Sebastian knows he's a funny guy and doesn't need these motherfuckers. I think we all know that. I mean, you know, people like you just shot your special, your stand-up special, and you know, we have the same manager. I bust Rick's chops, and we have the same guy, and we were talking about it, and I go, well, Rick, he's, you know, Joe, what the special is? It's a real funny motherfucker. A guy's a great comedian doing stand-up. You know, now, that's what you're selling. I mean, Joe's a funny fucker. There's a reason he's doing it for all this long. We're all here for this long, not because of a lark. We're good at this. You know, he's a funny guy. And if you could get that in your head, that's why you're here. It's not a trick.
But I don't know why I'm not super nervous, but because I've had a shitty financial month. Like, yeah. I this weekend is going on 3 weekends in a row with not a gig.
Yeah.
Because my agent.
It's hard, man.
My agent stinks, and they're jumping ship to go somewhere else, and they want me to sign.
That's
I go, amazing. How do I sign with you when you haven't done shit?
All the questions
you're
they ask.
Unsuccessful enough.
Right.
That's like no athlete could ask for more money if he bat fucking 091.
Yeah, it makes no sense. Again, there's no we're in a business where there's no other business like this. We talked about like the structure of paying commissions. There's no third party that would come in here who's independent with no opinion either way, no horse in the game, and look at it and go, we side with the managers. They're right. It's so terrible. It's just a complete ripoff system. And it's really embarrassing when a guy like Howard looks at it, because Howard really noticed that he had a deal with Robert Schimmel, Howard. And Schimmel's manager was Brillstein Gray, one of the biggest managers in the world. And Howard said to me, God, Schimmel's managers are involved with the script. What am I getting calls from this guy for? And he mentioned a manager's name. a guy who worked with Schimmel, who Brillstein Gray gave a job to. It's a name you'd know. And I go, I don't know, Howard. I go, who is this guy? I go, he's a manager. And he goes, why is he calling me about the script? I go, I don't know. He goes, do all you guys deal with this? You all have managers? Doesn't he have an agent? I go, yeah. I go, Howard, I don't. He specifically called me because he was mad. And I said, yeah, Howard, I have no explanation for it, dude. I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. It really is dumb. It's dumb. But that's what we thought you had to do to be successful.
Well, I wish I would have heard Howard today because I caught it right at the end of the episode, and he had Steve Miller on, and Steve Miller went full fucking. He was at a I don't care and just throwing anyone who fucked him in his whole career under the bus.
Oh, that's great.
I heard it because I only heard the after.
There's ways to hear it, I think, right?
Well, I have it in my car. I'm saying I only heard the wrap-up.
Right.
And them saying, wow, he really went all out. And I knew, you know, that I read the news story when it all happened where he was shitting on the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And I was like, I'm getting to that point. That's a sign we're getting older, too. When someone just takes somebody out, I'm like, I can't get enough of it. I love it.
See, I've always loved that. I've always had this rebel streak in me that's been very self-destructive in a lot of ways. It was since I was a kid in high school. That's why I got thrown out of high school. I was smart enough to get a fucking A in the stupid history class. I would say that to my mother. I said, Mom, you think I'm dumb? I can get an A in this fucking class. I go to kid up the street, Tony gets an A. You don't think I'm as smart as that jerk off? I'm bored to death. That's why I'm hitting Miss Fullcomer in the eye with a water pistol. I'm bored. The fucking idiot guidance counselor thinks I'm stupid. I'm not stupid. I'm smarter than you, jerkoff. I'm not interested in anything. And I'm angry for some reason. And then my old man felt like I got really angry. You get mad at everything, man. God, all that shit. Yeah, I love it. For a few years ago, Johnny Rotten from the Sex Pistols did not go to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He sent in a note. And Clive Davis, who's basically one of the people that runs the fucking Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, I give him a lot of credit. He read the note. And the whole thing was, it was so like, fuck you and your $3,000 plate fucking dinner. I'm not coming there. And yeah, I'm at the point, you know, you like the guys who say fuck off.
Yeah. Well, that was the thing with Steve Miller. They wouldn't let his band come, right? They wanted $3,000 ahead for his band members. He's like, what do you mean? It's the Steve Miller band.
The band had to pay.
Yeah, they wanted only he was allowed to come and his wife, and that was it.
Oh, Jan Wenner, the Scotsiad. It is. It's the Steve Miller band. Yeah. It's not right, and it's all I got the best of in my fucking room.
Yeah.
On cassette.
And there was something that they mentioned. There's something with him and Paul McCartney that was, I don't know all the details, that was like a...
When he was mad at Paul McCartney?
Was he mad at Paul McCartney?
I don't know. It just sounds great. First of all, we got it on demand. We could watch it.
I don't think, no, it wasn't him being mad at Paul McCartney. It was something like, I think Paul McCartney, maybe he liked some of his stuff and did something with it. I don't know. Steve Miller did a lot of really smart things with he was one of those guys, like the guys in our comedy world that are smart businessmen and talented.
Right.
Sounds like he was one of those guys who didn't get fucked over.
Could you name one of those guys in our world?
Well, like,
businessman and funny?
Louis C.K.
That's true. That's a good example. Absolutely. Yeah. What happened? Everyone's talking about this Brickleback and Fuckhead show.
Horace and Pete.
Okay, what am I thinking? Brickleback.
Is that what you're thinking about?
I'm thinking of Horace and Pete. Yeah.
Yeah.
He supposedly he was somewhere saying he's broke from that. Is that true?
Well, it was kind of a smart broke. Uh-huh. I mean, he lost a lot of money on
it. He can't be broke.
Because he literally tried to be so creative and unique.
You can't do
that.
You can't get too artsy.
That he made it secret.
Right.
He didn't even tell anyone it was launching.
Yeah, that's a little too artsy.
Just fucking stuck it on his podcast, on his website.
It's a little too artsy.
But then he went and started doing. He got a lot of news off of him supposedly losing money, which probably made him not lose money.
Right. Well, at some point, you got to use that to promote yourself. Promote the fact that you can't promote. You don't promote.
You know what? I saw Louis C.K. on like Fallon recently.
Right.
I thought this was pretty fucking cool. He started promoting other comedian shit just to be fucking weird.
Why? What do you do?
He's like, I'm sick of promoting my own stuff. Thanks for having me on, Jimmy. You know what? You guys should watch Samantha Bee's new talk show.
Right.
It's really good. She's funny. Right. He started naming people that he thought were funny. I'm like, this guy's doing that well. He's plugging other people's shit on the fucking Tonight Show.
Well, I tell you, we're going to go. This episode has proven that the Sklar Brothers don't have to be in the room to ruin comedy. They can do it from, they're practically calling it in. How long have we talked for, dude?
48 minutes.
Let's take a break.
but I like that. I like controversial. I'm not a shrinking violet. I like Artie Lang. I like his comedy.
All right. Are we on there? We're on here. Joe's walking around the kitchen. Are you all right, Joe? We're on the air. We have the
spoon is over there, Joe.
What are you looking for?
In the drawer.
No. Oh, he's eating?
Yeah.
What's he eating?
No, it's called. He's drinking coffee. He needs sugar.
Do you? Are you all right? Haven't taken Adderall.
Tired. I don't have any Adderall.
Yes, you do.
I swear to God.
You want? I can make one phone call. I gotta have 10 minutes. I can have. Well, it depends on if the elevator on the second floor is working.
No.
If the kid walks it up, he's got to take one. I said, "There's only 9 here." He goes, "Well, I had to walk up." Put a lot. We got sugar in there. Put a lot of sugar in there.
He's got it.
Put a Twinkie in there.
No.
There's cream in there.
I didn't see it.
Yeah, it's right at the right hand.
There's got to be cream in there. Did you bring? Is that your own cup?
No.
Where'd we get that cup, Dan?
That's mine.
That's your cup?
Yeah.
You bought a cup of your own cup of coffee?
No.
Where is it?
Top right hand. Top to the right.
It's the one that says cream.
Half and half.
Yeah, half and half.
How can you not see
it? It's also a sexual term.
Hold on.
I'll get up. Let me do it. I'm closer. Joe, get sit down. Don't hurt yourself. Just please, I'm going to interview you while we do this.
Hold
what
on.
What the fuck is that?
No, I'll leave it.
Okay.
It doesn't exactly jump out at you there.
You guys like to yell at me.
Someone
when I'm
might
right
have,
a lot.
She was cleaning and might have moved it.
She took it. This is hilarious. This is on the podcast.
Dan doesn't know. How could you not see it? Dan's looking for 5 minutes.
I'll have it flat. It's fine.
Dan can't find the cream. He was yelling at Joe about.
We talked about a gorilla. Now I'm having black coffee.
Dan can't find the fucking.
He's yelling at me. He's
Dan
got
is
fucking
yelling.
Cream
Dan
in there.
Is yelling at him.
He's like, it's up there in the right. It's called mustard, Dan. That's mustard. You found it?
Yeah.
He's like, here it is. How could you not see this?
How could you not see this? Behind 11 bags of fucking leftovers.
Yeah. What? It didn't exactly pop out at you. Thank
I
you.
I apologize, Joe.
Thank you, dude.
Dan, be a little more sincere.
It's always in the top right-hand corner.
What?
And it's unopened.
See, Dan has even spots for stuff in the refrigerator. That's how different we are. I haven't left my sneakers in the same spot since the eighth grade. What? So, Dan, you bought your own coffee cup? You bought a new coffee cup for yourself? That jumps out at you. It's a very special coffee cup.
I thought it was cool. And
where? Where'd you buy that?
I think Starbucks.
Oh. How much did they get you for that? $15 Starbucks.
It's a $20 mug.
I just thought it had a cool color.
Uh-huh. Should I just leave? Should I leave that there? That puts us right. That, you know, it's a perfect segue to the Dan Gay songs.
You know what I was thinking that was a subtle gay thing that is back from our time? But yeah. Not even subtle.
What is?
I don't know why I was. You know why I was thinking this today? I was planting flowers.
Right.
In a fucking pot. And it made me. You remember when Happy Days that the Fonz had a nephew that liked flowers and he was embarrassed? Yeah. And it was almost like a gay slam, but subtle.
It was a gay slam.
He was like, I like flowers.
Exactly.
And the Fonz was like, you what?
Yeah. Well, that was a lot of real unrealistic shit. Like the episode of Happy Days where Fonzie gets mad at everybody at Al's because they won't go to the party because a black kid's going to be there. And Sticks. And Fonzie tells him, well, you better be at that party. And, okay, the premise is an Italian uneducated hood in Milwaukee in 1956 is like Martin Luther King. He's sensitive towards the plight of the blacks, Fonzie.
You can't find one like that now in Milwaukee.
Yo, you're going to that party, the one with the African-American at it, right? Yo, it's the Fonz. Hey, you better go to the party with the African-American. My friend is African-American. I hear one of you guys use the term black. You're out of here. All right? He's smarter than you, I bet. You stereotypical assholes. He's hilarious. My friend, the Fonz. 1956 Italian guy. I love the black guy. I mean, the African-American.
Wasn't he embarrassed when his nephew liked flowers?
Yeah, of course. My nephew's a fag. Oh, my nephew likes flowers, if you know what I mean. My nephew bought his own coffee cup at Starbucks. He has a spot for the half and half in his refrigerator. Oh!
What did Dennis Miller say? That the dice was the Fonz with Tourette's?
With Tourette's. Probably the best fucking description of a person. I mean, you guys, what are you guys upset about? This guy's like Fonzie with Tourette's. Yeah, but yeah, they got a man. First guy to matriculate at the old girls' college was Dice Man. Yeah. Yeah, Nora Dunn wouldn't do the show this week, babe. What are you worried about? This guy's like Fonzie with Tourette's. Yeah, babe. Yeah.
Pardon me while I jetain back to Coolsville.
Yeah. My favorite was, what'd he say when, what'd he say? He said, when they, supposedly they were going to come out with an actual, like, what do they call that? Virtual reality where you wear the goggles and you could see something.
Yeah.
And they were supposedly going to come out with, it would look like you could fuck a supermodel. Like they were offering, some porn company offered Claudia Schiffer when she was like 23 years old all this money to be the chick you could fuck. Like a slob could put on those goggles. It looks like you're fucking Claudia Schiffer when you jerk off. And he goes, I got to tell you what, I don't know much about addiction, but if a regular fucking schlub in fucking Cincinnati can sit on his couch and it's like he's puts these goggles on, it's just like he's fucking Claudia Schiffer, gonna make crack look like Sanka.
Hey, man. They just mandated the you can also get AIDS from the people that turned you down.
I remember that.
It's hilarious. An AIDS joke in like the 80s.
Yeah. Now they got that. It was funny watching the old Eddie Murphy, that delirious his bit about it. Now they got that AIDS shit. Like, you're pretty sure you put your dick in and you just blow up. The shit on that delirious thing, you talk about politically correct. It's so, you know, we always talk about how he can never do that now. Rewatch it. It's even worse than we remember. I mean, hilarious. It's great. I mean, I was 16 and everybody in my high school knew that verbatim. Eddie Murphy was like the Beatles. He was that big. When 48 Hours came out and that HBO special, that was like the most impactful HBO special ever. Everybody thought they were going to be the biggest thing after HBO because of that. And because of how big he was after that. But he's in that red leather outfit and he's like, you know, we'll be funny faggots. Honeymooners will be funny faggots. Then he goes into a perfect Jackie Gleason. And, yeah, you know, we'll be funny faggots. The honeymoon, like, how would you like to fuck me in here?
People don't realize how hard that is to be that good of a stand up at that age. He was like 22.
23. He says his agent. He goes, I'm 23,
it's
man.
Crazy.
Well, he
started at 16.
Right. He lived a lot of life, grew up in Roosevelt, Long Island, and like, you know, 15 years old, he started doing stand-up. Jackie Martling was driving him home every night. You learn about life. Jackie's got stories about driving him fucking home from East End Comedy Club.
Is he really?
Yeah, making all racist jokes. There's that great story about a couple of great rumors about Eddie Murphy that if they're true, they're fucking great. Now, Ronnie Dangerfield saw him do stand up at the comic strip and said, hey, kid, you're great. But listen, if you want to be on fucking television, you curse too much. You got to be a little cleaner. I mean, you're not going to make it. You're not going to make any money in this business if you can't be on TV. You know, and what do you think's going to happen? You got to cut down with the F word. Like 5 years later, they're both in Las Vegas, supposedly. One's at the Mirage and one's at like the other. And they see each other in the bathroom. And supposedly they're pissing next to each other. This is the story. And Ronnie Dangerfield looks at Eddie Murphy and goes, who knew? The Colonel, Tom Parker, Elvis's manager, Eddie Murphy sitting next to him at the craps table. And is nervous because he's a big Elvis fan. And Tom Parker had no idea who he was. So Tom Parker looks at a black guy, a black kid sitting next to him. That wasn't something you saw a lot in Vegas when he was going to Vegas a lot. I mean, a black kid. He was 20 years old sitting next to him. He didn't know who he was. And he said, supposedly he said, come here, boy. I want to rub your head for luck. That's fucking great. So anyway, Dan bought a cup for $50. That's got to be $15 at Starbucks. I've never saw someone that's a man do that. It's all broads. That's not on my credit card, is it?
No.
If that cup comes up on my fucking credit card. My fucking business manager, who used to be my bookie, calls me up and goes, I got, it says Starbucks here. You know anything about this on the Visa? Gay coffee cup. All right. So people have been sending it. My audience is getting very attentive to the show. And the gay coffee cup, I'm telling you right now, it's a mandate. In the next song parody, you got to put a reference into that. And I want Joe Matarese and the half and half in there.
And the gold cup.
And the gold cup. And so this one,
and we can probably get the rights to Black Coffee in Bed by Squeeze.
Oh yeah. Clearly we're not caring about rights anymore. They went out the window. Rights.
Made out of. Took too long. It's like melted Oscar.
Looks like the gold tooth old dirty bastard had it. This cup was made possible because three of the Wu-Tang Clan got shot last night in the fucking Marcy in the Marcy houses in Brooklyn with the fucking with Jay-Z's father. God damn it. Three of the Wu-Tang. The reason we got this is because Reza got shot next to fucking next to ODB. Eazy-E's father got his tooth pulled last night. So that fork Starbucks coffee cups and the Starbucks in Compton, which is a really popular right across the street from the Coffee Bean and a Church's Fried Chicken, doing very well. Church's Fried Chicken and Kentucky Fried Chicken right across. You know you're in a bad neighborhood when two fried chicken franchises are across the street from one another. And neither one's hurting for business. If you know what I'm saying, there's a Church's right next to a Popeyes, and both of them are doing very well. The Coffee Bean went out of business when they figured out that they had to wait for two of the local rap artists to die to get the gold teeth to make the gold cup. And Dan Filato, on the off chance Dan Filato strolls in because Artie's playing USC across the street. Artie's opening up for Domerera. Tom Dreesen's doing a quick warm-up set for him and him and Tom Shalhoub on a big political.
I actually think that's a funny bit. Actually, is the Churches and a.
I have a joke.
You do about two of them.
Yeah, because I went. I opened up for Norm at USC. And I said, Norm, there's a Church's and a Popeye's fried chicken right across the street. Both of them had long lines. That was my first joke. It's like a 10-minute like laugh. Well, the white kid, USC is a you know in the LA riots when the guy the truck driver gets pulled out of the thing and the guy hits him with a brick.
Yeah.
Okay. That USC is a block from that. You know, a block from Florida.
Reginald
Denny.
That was one of my old. I used to say I went to Denny's and they had the Reginald Denny burger on the menu.
Perfect.
So I ordered it, and three black guys hit me in the face with a brick. That was the joke. Reginald Denny burger.
The punchline should have been too. You know, incidentally, the same thing happened before that too. I never did that in a special or anything. Maybe I'll bring that back.
That poor fucking guy. What's Reginald Denny up to? Is he still alive?
He just formed a sentence for the first time since 19.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, God.
But here's trivia. The name of the kid who hit him with the brick, because he was on the talk show. That kid's on the talk show circuit for a while.
Wasn't it the same kid who stuck his glove over?
Not Jeffrey Mayer.
I know Jeffrey Mayer.
The greatest guy in the history of the Yankees. The direct opposite of Bartman. The 180 of Steve Bartman is our guy. That's a cursed team and a not cursed team.
Those guys should go out and do a show together.
Steve Bartman, if you're a Cub fan, Steve Bartman does it when the home team's in the field. If you're a Yankee fan, it's when the home team's up. That play wasn't even near a home run. That was in 96, Jeter's rookie year. When Jeter hit that and Jeffrey Mayer basically took the ball out of the glove of an Oriole, you go, Jeter's blessed. He's touched by the gods. He was touched by the gods. Mariah Carey swallowed that night. Motherfuckers.
Oh, God.
Jeffrey Mayer, by the way, you know, they had a big article on him. 10 years later, he was 22, and he was in, like, the minor leagues. Somebody drafted him, I think, just for the story.
Oh, really?
And he sucked bad. But they put him in. They had a picture of him. I think now he works at the Churches or a Popeyes, one of the things.
I still remember there's always, like, there's always, like, a comic that could have a lot of shitty bits, but then they have one that's good, and you go, did they steal this bit?
How did that happen, exactly.
Or did they just did it just line up for them?
See, it's that unbelievable to you that out of nowhere they could have one brilliant thing.
Yeah, this one kid, Scott Papacuri, he was like Papakuri. I don't know if you ever knew him. He's a big drug addict.
Yeah.
He fucking went way far off the deep end. I'm sure he's appreciating that I'm saying. I still have Dennis Miller's cadence in my brain right now. You fucking...
I got a feeling Scott Papakuri. You know what? Not for nothing, Artie. You're starting to look like Scott Papakuri and Otto and George on a fucking buffalo run with the dummy in the Artie and Papakuri.
Papakuri had a bit about Jeffrey Mayer peaking. That he peaked too young.
I don't know, 12 years old.
Yeah, and he goes, I can see that kid in like 10 years, you know. He's going to be like fucking, he's going to be like having to suck some fucking black cock for crack.
Papakuri referencing his own life from
And so I remember the punchline was something like, hey, he's like fucking going down on this guy for fucking crack money. And he's like, you know, I'm the kid who caught the ball at the Yankee thing. And he's like, just suck it. I still remember that bit. I was like, that's actually funny.
Really? I'm an Oriole fan.
Yeah, already tagged it. Just suck it.
I happen to have Scott Papakuri right here. Let me bring him out. Joe, this is your life. Scott Papakuri's here, shaking like a leaf. And I put a bicycle chain on his neck. He sounded like the ghost of Christmas past. I don't want to say shaking too much from the cracks, but I used to do a bit about Alexander Graham Bell invented the telephone when he was 28. Where are you going from there? You know, it's like it's the goddamn telephone. Like the rest of us, he's 38 in the patent office going, no, it's also a paperweight. It's a toaster and a pen. Nah, not working. It's not as good. You're not getting the same juice. It's a toaster and a paperweight. Mm-hmm. No, it's not the phone, buddy. It's just not the telephone. Sorry, Alex. It's just not the telephone. All right, Dan. So let's play Chicago. They said
the name. You were going to give us the name of the, you said trivia. The name of the guy who hit with the brick.
Oh, Football Williams.
That's right.
His first name was Football. He did the talk show circuit for a while. Yeah. He's the guy who hit him with the brick.
That was his name?
Football. Well, I maybe it was made up. You start to realize when you get older why the black comics have Bruce and Earthquake and stuff. It's because they can't have the real name out there.
I didn't even think of that.
Earthquake alludes to it. And that great bit he does. He goes, not even a fuck. I was sitting in the 2004 election with John Kerry. I'm sitting there eating a sandwich on my bed, 3 o'clock on a Tuesday afternoon. I see Puff Daddy on MTV going, you got to get out and vote. I'm like, this shit must be serious. Got out there waiting online for 3 fucking hours. This nigga Kerry lost by 3 million fucking votes. Now these white people got my real name. Like, fuck you, Puff Daddy. You know shit about voting. Stick to remixing. this shit must be serious. Oh, God. Yeah, the Earthquake's not his real name, supposedly. all right, Dick. Yeah, so this is Chicago doing a get. This is, you know, the song Saturday in the Park, Joe?
Yeah.
Saturday. Dan is gay in the park. Rick Steves shot cum in his eye. That's the lyric. Yeah.
You've heard this already?
We heard it about a million times. Makes me laugh. Yeah,
I'm already laughing.
Yeah, lower it a little.
Has like this been played on your show yet?
About a million times.
Dan is gay in Denmark. You let Rick Steves shoot cum in his eye. Dan is gay in Denmark. You let Rick Steves shoot cum in his eye. No use lying, no denying. Two men shooting white cream. Playing with their dog.
He stopped it there. That's all he had. That's all I got.
It stopped. It's almost even funnier that he doesn't really sing that well. It makes it hilarious.
It's so bad. It's funny. That's why it's funny. It's so bad.
Now, whose shot come in your eye?
Rick Steves.
Rick Steves.
Yeah. In Denmark, he let Rick Steves shoot coming.
Oh, in Denmark.
Okay, Dan. So what is this, Dan? We got another one. We got a bunch I can't find on my Twitter. Some guy sent in an amazing one to give me shelter.
I didn't get that one. This one is.
Fucking find it.
If I remember the group's name, it's Four Blondes, Four Non-Blondes.
I don't know what's the song.
It's
What's Going On?
Yeah. Something like that's it. Yeah,
you
yeah,
know
yeah.
knows that.
That's again, Dan. You're pretending.
Yeah.
When Dan does this, he's afraid I'm going to call him gay because he knows like old girls. Dan, that's a huge song. You're not gay for knowing that song.
I don't remember the name of the group.
Yeah. Okay. Well, who cares about the group? The song is more important.
Right. There's not much to this song, so yeah,
but it's a huge song. You're not gay for knowing that song.
Already funny.
Exactly. He used my voice without my permission, just so you know.
That's the best thing ever. It's a great song, by the way. The long intro.
Nice build.
Oh, God.
25 years and my life is still trying to get up that great big hill of hope for a destination.
That's the real song.
That's the real song. Wait.
I realized quickly when I knew I should that the world was made up of this brotherhood of man.
What the fuck?
Wait.
For whatever that means. Into a crisis.
Wait.
I hope he never sings. I hope this is the whole song. This is great.
And so I wake in the morning and I step outside and I take a deep breath and I get real high and I scream from the top of my lungs.
I'm a fucking fag. That's it. I already almost fell off the couch. I'm a fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag.
Oh my God. That's the most brilliant thing I've ever heard of. That's the most brilliant thing I've ever heard in my life. Okay, who did that, Dan? Just hire him.
John Dempsey.
Oh, John Dempsey.
It's 5 minutes. A song, 5 minutes. This is all he's got.
That's it.
Did we get the joke? Shut it, shut it. You can stop it.
God.
Oh, that's fucking great. It's almost like, it's like, it is. It's a great song. You want to hear it, but lulls you into this. He just yells, I'm a fan. It's like you're calling a press conference.
The best is how long it took before we got it.
He let it go. He let it go until we're hooked. And it's just long enough to where you go, wait, I like this song. I remember that day. We grilled you a little too much about the Rick Steves and you lost it. You're right. I'm a fucking fan.
Nailed it.
That is fucking amazing. John Dempsey. God bless you, John Dempsey. I want to interview John Dempsey. All these guys. One guy sent in a brilliant one to Gimme Shelter. The references, they do listen to the show very closely. Some guy did a Gimme Shelter. He references like four episodes. We got to get the gay cup in the next one. Again, I've seen this the gorilla video 14 times already. I'm looking at it. This poor, and the kid is, you know, the kid is oddly calm. The kid's kind of just looking around. Look at him.
It's very strange that kid is that calm.
Well, you see, black kids are just tough. I don't know, Joe.
That sounded kind of racist.
We should kind of cut that out.
It's really funny, though.
Joe, cut that one. We'll cut it.
I'm about to go to LA actually and should take cut some that. Media.
Joe's getting a little too loose. It's becoming like, you know, we're just talking. I'm a fucking fag.
Oh God,
Dan, that is the best thing ever. I never laughed that hard in a long time.
I emailed.
I don't know what to expect. You know what, Dan? I'm giving you props. I'm giving you props for not playing that before the air.
I didn't want to.
I bet you probably don't know how funny
I didn't want him to lose
is.
Interest.
But you don't know how funny it is when you're listening to that by yourself. It's more like we were just waiting and it was just building. And when Artie laughed,
he almost fell off the couch.
His feet went in the air.
I ran. I'm not. I pulled something.
He looked like Fred Flintstone when he would bowl, and he would go ding ding ding. Like your feet just fucking went airborne.
Fred Flintstone when he bowled. No, I look like the fat guy in the Burlington Coat commercial. The family jumps up and down for a sale. that's not realistic. I mean, you know one fat guy who's about 38 with three kids or jumps that high for a Burlington coat sale? But for that joke, I will. Holy shit, that's great.
This isn't nearly as funny as what that song was, but the comedian Barry Diamond,
yeah,
he was in that movie Bachelor Party. That was like his big
movie. Which was he playing that?
He was I remember a scene where he just hits a fucking tennis ball with a fucking racket like over the fence, like and acts like he hit a home run.
That's Tom Hanks does that in the movie Bachelor Party.
All right. Barry Diamond.
You don't know that's Tom Hanks who does that?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
You know what you just made it as funny as the song? Barry, like the most obscure guy, the biggest star in the history of movies, is in that movie. He's the one who does it. There's no one else who does it. You know, Tom Hanks is the
Barry
lead of the
Diamond did it in that movie, but he's one of the friends of the Tom Hanks in the movie.
There's well, I
a
remember,
pretty big part.
Yeah, but he's not the guy who hits the thing. The guy who hits it is not an obscure guy.
You would recognize him because he was like a
well,
stand-up comic
I,
that was
that's
in
why
a lot
I asked
of weird
you.
Shit.
All those guys are funny in that movie. There's Tom Hanks' brother who is married to the little fat chick that's in every 80s comedy, mm-hmm. and he's a dentist or something, mm-hmm. and he wants to get laid. He's like, he can't wait to fuck a chick at the bachelor party. He's real horny. That might be the guy because I know every there's Adrian, there's the French guy from the T.J. Hooker show, I'll and Grease 2.
You can know it's
the Grease 2 guy. Whose name I forget. It's like a French name.
Adrian Zemed.
Oh, it's Med.
Adrian Zemed.
Adrian Zemed is in it.
Don't you remember Dennis Miller's Adrian Zemed bit?
Yes. Well, no, that's why I know. I remember. And I think it's like one of those movies
It's just sunk in that Zemed replaced Terrio on Dance Fever. That's all I remember. Zemed.
Yeah, I saw Grease 2 on Broadway. Not as good as 1. I'm trying to think who else it could be. Barry Diamond might be the guy because he's the only guy I don't really know, you know, of his friends. There's a guy who plays a mechanic who's like a big maniac. He's like the Bluto Blutarski of it.
Here he is. This is him now, but...
Let me see. I would know the face now if he's the guy I'm thinking of. Get the fuck up for the Barry Diamond story.
I got a shorter wire.
What? Barry Diamond? Yeah, Barry. Yeah, he's the mechanic. He plays the guy. He's in the mechanic suit. He's got a big part. Yeah, he's one of his friends who goes to the bachelor party.
Well, I worked with him at Catch a Rising Star in Princeton back when that was a really good club back in like the early 90s.
I played it a couple times. By the way, do you know how wrong you are in him being the guy who hit the tennis ball? There's not a chance
he was. Like me saying he was Spicoli.
That's like saying Richard Castellano played Vito Corleone. That's like saying the guy who played Clemenza. The guy who played Clemenza is. I think he played Vito. No, he played Clemenza. It's not even that bad. I'm trying to think of something worse. It's like saying, like on Happy Days. It's like saying I think he played the mother of Richie Cunningham. No, you're thinking of Marion Ross, and I'm thinking of Fonzie. It's that you're that off. I just remember a guy in the movie. I remember a guy in the movie hitting a tennis ball. So when you started to say it, I'm thinking, okay, that's Tom Hanks did that. I think, did I miss a part where he's over? On the day they shot those parts, I guarantee this guy wasn't even working. I bet he had the day off.
He definitely did.
I bet he was wrapped. I bet he wasn't in Los Angeles.
We're going to forget even why I brought him up.
I bet the day they shot those Tom Hanks things, you were working with him to catch Rising Star.
Oh, you're right.
So what happened?
I think I've told this on your podcast before, but
I don't remember this.
He would come on. The guy can sing incredibly, right. And you're not expecting it. They go, ladies and gentlemen, he's been in the Bachelor Party. He's been on this show and that show. Give it up for your headliner tonight, Mr. Barry Diamond. And he comes out, fucking the Four Non Blondes song starts, and he sings it from beginning to end. The whole fight, you hear
you're
how long.
Kidding me.
Fucking just crushes it. That's, sings 5 minutes of perfect. Fantastic. But no, here's the funny part. When he gets done, they almost give him like a standing ovation. That's how well he sings it without a joke.
Right.
And then he just goes, thank you, good night, which is like an old comedian.
What if he just yelled out, I'm a fucking fag?
He is gay. That's what's funny. I think
no.
he's gay.
Is he?
I think so.
Well, we can't think of it.
There's another edit. Let's
we think.
So here's here's what's funny. He goes, "Thank you, good night." And usually a comedian will take a step to the left and then come back on, like that's the joke. He says, "Thank you, good night," and walks out of the fucking comedy club and stays out for fucking 4 minutes. I'm not lying. The whole crowd's looking around like, "What the fuck? Just where the fuck? What the fuck?" Yeah. And he just fucking milks it, and then he comes back in like 4 minutes later, and he's a whole new character now, and does like a gay guy for like fucking 20 minutes.
Maybe
he's,
really,
had,
maybe
he's
really
bizarre.
Had to, well, maybe you really had to get back into character after that emotional. He goes to that emotional place.
I just like comedians when I you like you said you like the rebels. I would like comedians that would fucking like lose the room.
Well, that sounds rebellious. Losing the room is rebellion.
Yeah, loved
it's
it.
The biggest rebellious thing you can do. Oh yeah, that's hilarious.
Is there more songs? I want to hear more now.
We do. We have. I can't find it. The guy tweeted them to me. A guy. I can't.
I have Barry Diamond. They have it on YouTube singing that song.
No, we don't. I don't want to hear that.
Can't you pull? Can't you pull Artie's Twitter and find the
guys
Rolling Stones?
Up, guys, pull up my Twitter like a Cincinnati Silverback pulls
well,
a kid out of
there's
a fucking
two other ones.
Type.
Huh?
What do you mean there's two other ones?
Well, the Ballad of Dan Filato that we heard.
That's too long. And it's not. I love it, but
and
it's
then
too obscure.
The Diabetic Piss, How I Hate
oh,
You.
Oh, yeah. Okay, go ahead. Try let Joe hear that. This was what to what song?
Christ, no, I forgot. I forgot.
Okay. I say all the time I got to take a diabetic I'm a piss. I got to take a diabetic piss on the show. I tell you so. So that's to this. Go ahead, Joe.
Does Dan hate Ari? I want to know. Why is he trying to ruin the show? Is it jealousy? You know it's all his fault. Is it jealousy? Show comes to a screeching halt. If you want to know why Dan sabotages the show, because he's jealous. Diabetic piss. Is it jealousy? You know it's all his fault. Is it jealousy?
Show comes to a screeching halt.
Show comes to a screeching halt. Why did sabotage the show? Cause he's jealous. Diabetic piss.
That's what we need. They go into like fucking guitar solos.
Dude, these people, like, it makes me want to learn how to use guitar band or guitar. What's it called? The fucking Mac editing software.
Right, they're amazing.
GarageBand.
Like, they're fucking overdubbing their voice 30 times. It's unbelievable.
They're fucking so again, the worse the better. And oh it's just God. That is really fucking funny, man.
And it is funny when you realize they picked up something that you forgot you even talked about.
They listen intently. Radio fans are very passionate.
How do they know that it's crazy?
Well, I would I do a bit about how like Dan, you know, was jealous of what I did on Stern and tried to do it in Chicago, and you know, of course, that's not a real premise. And no, they pick up on that shit. Like, it's not, that's not even a really big theme. We talked about it one day. And this diabetic piss out of nowhere, just a non sequitur.
Yeah, where'd that come from?
Well, I say that all
he
the time.
He says that.
Well, I gotta take a diabetic piss.
Diabetic piss. I feel it gets me more sympathy. All right, so one more point here about a news story. You know, what Trump is doing right now is so fucking amazing to me. He's playing the media like fucking fiddles. He had this big news conference today where he claimed that he raised $5.6 million. He said $6 million, so $6 million for the veterans, the vets, the biggest charity you could raise for right now. You know, you're gonna get a lot of feathers in your cap if you raise money for the vets. So he picks that charity, which is brilliant, and he says that's the reason he doesn't do the last Fox debate. He didn't want to go because Megyn Kelly was there, and he was all pissed off at her because she was pissed at him. He felt she wouldn't treat him fairly. So Roger Ailes of Fox digs his knees into the sand and goes, "No, we're not letting Megyn Kelly leave. You have to do the show with her." And Trump goes, "Fuck you. I'll have my own event across town." So he has his own event across town, gets a huge ratings that he takes away from the debate, and he claims he raises $6 million for the vets. So, okay, just picture the premise that just assume that Trump throws that out there as bait. And he figures, okay, the liberals are all going to come at me. All my enemies are going to come at me and go, "Did he really raise that money? I don't think he did." And then just say he's going to all those people in a room. Don't do anything. Don't send money to anybody. Because they got to vet the charities anyway. But we're going to send the money, but don't send it yet. And let these motherfuckers come at me. And
if that's the case, I'm not saying that happened. If that's the case, they took the bait like a fucking a gorilla taking a 3-year-old. I mean, he lured them in. He lured all of these liberal press guys who he hates into the fucking field for the slaughter. Like Vlad the Impaler. He made up with all his enemies. Remember that story? And he invites them all over for a big luncheon. And he fucking impales them all when they get there. That's what he did to the press. All these people who can't stand him, who he hates, they come in. And now he goes, now release the money. Now I have proof. And give me all the names and all the checks. And I'll give the numbers. And I'll show that I'm right, they're wrong. And for an hour, I'm going to read off all the money I gave to all the vets. And all the vets who love me because I gave them money are going to stand right behind me. Those old vet guys who you can't argue with because they were in World War II. They got one eye because they got shot down by Hitler. Goebbels himself stabbed their eye. And then they got the hat, the fucking medals. They're all behind Trump. He for an hour, he rattles off $1 million, $600,000, blah, blah, blah. Gives more money to the charity than anybody in one day ever gave. Now, all his enemies are just, they look stupid. They look dumb. They basically gave him a forum to look great. And then one by one, he just calls them assholes. This guy, he calls one guy from ABC, this guy's a sleaze. He just lies all the time. And is this guy a sleaze? Everybody claps. The guy's sitting there going, he goes, you lie all the time. You didn't think I'd do this. You said, I go, well, we were just asking you about, were you going to send the money? Well, I did. What do you have to say now? And the guy just looks there stupid. He looks like a moron. And he's getting everybody in the back to clap. Vets are calling the guy an asshole. Veterans. You're like your grandfather in a vet hat are going, yeah, you're right. He's a sleaze, Donald. And what's the guy going to do? Get up and walk out? It would be like a comedy club guy wearing a shitty t-shirt, get up to piss with Sam Kinison on stage. Basically, if the guy got up to sleek out of there, Trump would just roast him. He had to sit there. I'm not saying that's how it went down. Maybe it really took this long to vet the companies and he pulled, you know, they yelled at him and he brought them all in. Maybe it happened the way he said it happened. But let's just say that's how he did it. You guys are getting played like fools. He's making you look so dumb. He invited you. What did you think he was going to do? Why would he invite you guys to a press conference? Because he didn't send the money? He invited you all to a press conference to announce he sent the money. You don't think he was definitely sure of that before he got there? How else could you look but stupid? So the one guy goes, is this what it's going to be like covering you as president? Or are you just going to like call us? He goes, if you lie, sure. If you lie like a scumbag, I'm going to call you a scumbag. And the guy goes, oh, okay. That was the guy's question. It's comical. These aren't bright people. You think all these people cover politics, all these surrogates. I watch it every day now because I'm so fascinated by it. I'm starting to learn shit I never knew. They're all just dummies. You think cool people go into this business? They don't. They work for Google. You never know what they look like. Cool motherfuckers don't become surrogates and pundits for politicians. And it seems none of them cover the fucking news either. Who takes that invitation? Donald Trump says, yeah, I want you to come to a press conference. You have the front row, buddy. You're going to be front and center. Every camera is going to be on your face. There's a guy at ABC he hates. And that guy's such a fucking egomaniac, he takes it. Okay, I'll sit here. What do you think is going to happen? You think he's going to have a press conference and go, you were right. I didn't send any of the money. God, it was so brilliant, man. And he took, and now he's got them trapped, by the way. They can't leave. And he just milked it. Every single vet he called up, he hugged the guy. Every time he hugged the guy, I got a huge applause. And every time he got hugged by the guy would go, by the way, you're right, that guy's a sleaze. A guy who works for ABC News? Okay, well, all right. Yeah, you're right there, you're a sleaze. All right. Trump, it could have taken Trump 10 minutes to rattle off. He made it an hour and a half on national television. CNN, I checked, CNN, Fox, even the libs and liberals at MSNBC didn't leave it like it was the State of the Union address. No commercials. That guy got called a sleaze for an hour and a half. You know, if you're going to act like a fucking idiot, you're going to get treated like one, I guess. And then he goes, the big question, he goes, I want you to do me a favor.
I want you to check how much money Hillary Clinton's given to vets. And of course, there was a guy with a all those stats was right next to him. By coincidence. Zero. She's given nothing. She made $25 million in the last 2 years to give speeches to Goldman Sachs. He has that stat. How much of that did she give to veterans? Zero. Oh, there's a coincidence. Trump knew that too. And the vets boo Hillary Clinton. He needs votes in these certain states, man. And he's not letting up. It's really fascinating. And Hillary Clinton continues to yell into the microphone. It is the most annoying sound I've ever heard in my life when she fucking yells. And she yells bumper stickers. We don't need insults. We need results. Shut the fuck up, you phony. Ugh. That voice. Trump should keep harping on the fact that it's a broad with an annoying voice. He keeps going, oh, when she yells, it's so terrible. It annoys the shit out of me. What does every guy think of? Did you bring the keys? Did you fix the air conditioner? Did you take the towels like I told you for the kids? Did you take the dog out? We don't need insults. We need results. That's what every guy thinks.
Brilliant
play. All you could do is say, well done, Donald. Unbelievable. Joe, your thoughts? You know, it is interesting, though. You learn a lot about, like, again, I never follow politics that much, but it's so entertaining right now. It's so entertaining. And do you know what a surrogate is? Because, I mean, I'm not saying that to give you shit. I didn't know what it was till this year. I mean, I heard of it. But you know what a political surrogate basically does, like what their function is, sort of? I just know because I'm watching. I just heard it this year. Dan, do you have, what do they do? Do you know what they do? You probably do.
They're a spokesperson for the candidate.
Right, exactly. But here's the key. Probably, almost definitely paid, right?
Yes.
On their payroll.
Or sure. Promised a job in the cabinet.
In some way they're rewarded.
Right.
Right. Okay. Everybody has a certain amount this year. They all seem retarded. They're all so stupid. Some of them are kind of smart. The smart ones stand out. The ones Trump has, he literally, to save money, hired people who were apprentice contestants. Really? They're not even educated. Oh, there's one woman who just goes, I would just vote for Mr. Trump. Yeah, but you know, he lied when he said this. Yeah, I guess, but people lie. What are you saying? I don't know. I would vote for Mr. Trump. Mm. She's talking to Matt Lauer. Mm. All they have to do is, a surrogate has a really hard job. Basically, they get some sort of reward, and all they tell them to do is, no matter what happens in this verbal fight, you're going to be on with Anderson Cooper, with Jake Tapper, with all these motherfuckers. No matter what, you're for Mr. Trump. No matter what. If Mr. Trump rapes a woman on national television, you're for Mr. Trump. I don't care what. Well, you know, rape is against the law. Yeah, well, she was kind of asking for it. So you're saying it was okay. I would vote for Mr. Trump. Hillary has them. Trump has them. Obama had them. It's unbelievable. It's all so phony. They're obviously paid. Could they have the same opinion every single time? And every legitimate news corporation has them on. CNN. MSNBC, Fox, they all have these people on who are clearly paid by the candidate to say that guy's right and you're wrong.
And what will they say? What will they give at? I mean, what will they title them when they come on?
To their credit, they kind of go, well, that's a good point. They say, okay, such and such is, they'll give their credits. Used to write for National Review Magazine, blah, 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 and is a supporter of Donald Trump. That's what they say, you know.
Okay.
At the end, they say supporter of Donald Trump. But they kind of do it real quick. And then there's other people who support Hillary and blah, 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 and they fight back and forth. What's funny about they're all despicable. Don't get me wrong. But what's funny about the Trump ones is some of the Trump shit is so ridiculous. It's stuff you never hear politicians doing. He called them a sleaze. What does that mean? I don't know. Sleaze bag. I've heard sleaze before. Do you think that's presidential? I don't know. John F. Kennedy had sex with women.
I have it queued up right to where he calls them a sleaze if you want it.
Go ahead. Yeah. This is at that press conference. So Donald Trump leads these guys into a press conference, and this is what he does to the guy. We ate.
Okay, here we go.
I raise millions of dollars, have people say, like this sleazy guy right over here from ABC. He's a sleaze in my book. You're a sleaze because you know the facts, and you know the facts well. Go ahead.
And he brings up the veterans right after that.
Watch, listen, it's amazing.
Thank you, Mr. Trump. First of all, for the record, I'm a state representative from New.
That's where it stops, the clip.
You felt necessary to play that part. The state rep. Okay, it stops there.
Well, no, he was a veteran. He's one of the veterans.
I know, but why would you play that? You play the four words he said.
I didn't know that it stopped there.
Just play the what's going on. Can you play more of the Trump thing? Do you have more of it?
Yeah, I've got the right from the beginning. Okay.
I thought we were going to hear more of that. Look, when this started, I think you were there. I said if we could raise $1 million, that would be good. And we ended up raising almost $6 million. And I'm going to have more coming in over a period of time.
Don't you believe you should be accountable to the people?
I'm totally accountable. But I didn't want to have credit for it. Now, actually, what I got was worse than credit because they were questioning me. And this is money. And by the way, most of that money went out very early, just so you understand. But a lot of these groups getting vetted by, you know, when you pay the money out, they need government documentation. They need a lot of different things. Plus, we want to find out, is it a good group? I had teams of people reviewing statistics, reviewing numbers, and also talking to people in the military.
Perfectly legitimate point, by the way.
The group was deserving of the money. We have given to groups that are unbelievable groups. And honestly, I wish you could hear the phone calls and see the letters. They are so happy. And I'm happy to do it. I didn't want the credit for it, but it was very unfair that the press treated us so badly. Yeah, go ahead.
To follow up on that, you keep calling us the dishonest press, the disgusting press.
Generally speaking, that's 100% true. Go ahead.
I disagree with that, sir. And if I can ask you this question, it seems as though you're resistant to scrutiny, the kind of scrutiny that comes with running for president of the United States.
But you know what? When I raise money, excuse me, I've watched you on television. You're a real beauty. When I raise money,
Mr. Trump,
you talked about not wanting to get credit for this. You did host a very public fundraiser that was televised.
How else am I going to raise the money?
Sorry?
How else am I going to raise the money?
What I'm asking, I guess, is when you did this fundraiser, it was televised, you were doing
sure.
Instead of doing the debate, it received wide attention. Some
sure.
People say that it may have helped your campaign.
I would have given this out, just so you understand. Until I was criticized. So I'm the only one in the world could raise almost $6 million for the veterans, have uniform applause by the veterans groups, and end up being criticized by the press.
Night of that Iowa fundraiser, you said you had raised $6 million. Clearly you had not. Your critics say you tend to exaggerate, you have a problem with the truth. Is this a prime example?
Listen to this guy.
No, I raised almost $6 million. Some of it didn't come through, but more money is coming through than didn't come through. You know, close to six.
But what you're doing is you're answering the questions now that we had back then. It was just a question. Is a question an attack?
I think, and I've been dealing with the press a long time, I think the political press is among the most dishonest people that I've ever met. I have to tell you that, okay? Of course, you're excluded, Carl. But I think the political press...
Wait a few minutes.
I think the political press... I see the story many more people than they had. So instead of saying Trump made a speech in front of a packed crowd, they said Trump was disappointed here, and they could admit, I didn't want to do that. I'm not looking for credit, but what I don't want is when I raise millions of dollars, have people say, like this sleazy guy right over here from ABC, he's a sleaze in my book. You're a sleaze because you know the facts, and you know the facts well. Go ahead.
Then he says, go ahead. Again, these guys all, how dumb are they? Every guy goes, you said you're going to raise $6 million. Well, yeah, I did. Why are you announcing it now? And then he brings up a perfectly legitimate thing. I had to check the companies. I'm not just going to mail a check to these people. I got to vet them. and later on in the day, everybody went on Trump's side. Everybody. ABC, all these people had to put out statements that we apologize for the way our reporters acted. The one guy might be fired.
Wow.
You know, again, it's Trump's good. He's good.
He has the he has the sound and presence as he's killing everybody. Yeah. It reminds me of Walken in True Romance. I don't know why the whole eggplant scene, the way he's just like, yeah.
You're going to die.
You're going to die. And
that scene's great. Yeah.
I haven't killed any. Well, I don't know. I don't know the fucking all the words, but it's just my. It just sounded.
Just play the what's going on. yeah, it was. You know, if they're going to keep acting that way, it's going to be easy because it also gives him a forum to bring up Hillary's fucking negatives, and there's a lot of those. This email thing. I mean, what she did is indictable. And I mean, there's people who did a lot of time who did a lot worse. What Petraeus did, what that general Petraeus did, is like a college prank compared to what Hillary Clinton did. You're talking about 3,000 emails that were classified information out there to get hacked. There's a guy in prison right now who said I was in her email in like a day. You don't think fucking the Russians and Iran have people who could do that? They claim that there were spies who probably couldn't believe how easy it was. They thought that maybe it was too easy. This could not be Hillary Clinton's email. Like, I think a kid in high school got in. So what does she have to do? She might have to cut a deal. She might have to say, look, to Barack Obama, I'll step down. I won't put you guys in any more fucking danger, the Democratic Party, but you gotta give me a pardon. I'm going to be 70. I'm responsible for a lot of black people being in jail.
Right? No.
Yeah, you got to get me out of the joint. I can't go into Gen Pop at fucking Stateville. And Barack Obama goes, all right. I knew the Clintons would come crawling back. And she gives him the old Gerald Nixon pardon. Gerald Ford fucking Richard Nixon pardon. People forget that. Nixon was going to do time. A president said, okay, no, he's pardoned. And that might happen here. But who's going to run? Give me Dan. Joe Biden, Dan, who's going to run? Elizabeth Warren, who are they going to? They got to pull somebody out of their ass. People like Joe Biden, but he's 70 years old too. Like he doesn't want to do it.
He doesn't want to run.
No, kid, he's still mourning his kid. You know,
Howard Stern.
You never know. You never know. Listen, Trump Stern. There's a debate you'd watch.
That's a good one.
Well, remember why Howard didn't? You know, Howard didn't go and become a governor. What got him out of the race? He was fucking. He was getting votes, man. When you had to release your financial reports, Howard's like, "Fuck you." Yeah, fuck you. You're not seeing that shit. And it's not arrogance by these rich guys, especially celebrities, do that. It's like, you know, they're worried about, you know, the kids getting kidnapped and you know, the Entertainment Weekly reports Forbes, they report richest people in Hollywood. You know, it's just a publicist giving you a report. Cameron Diaz has a movie coming out, so she's number one on the list. That's, you don't think Steven Spielberg is number one every year? Those guys pay people to stay off that list because they don't want their kids getting kidnapped by some dirtbag who read in Forbes magazine their father has $1 trillion from Schindler's List alone.
They're not smart enough to figure it out.
Yeah, well, it's something about, there's something about psychologists, they've interviewed them about them, when they see that number in a magazine, they start doing math in their head. It's bad.
All the
to have a psychopath. Steven Spielberg, the money Steven Spielberg has from Jurassic Park alone, he could pay Cameron Diaz to mop his house every fucking week. By the way, we got to give Joe props. He was right about Brian Regan. Brian Regan did not read that in the paper. I did. I remember that he said that. I read later that there was a big uproar about jobs. The cable company was firing all these people because of that story. Regan, one of the best stand-ups ever, who mostly does observational shit. That's my point about Joe. Joe, that, like, in other words, you do a lot of great family stuff. So the news story in your life is, I had a kid, and you observe that, and you do a great stuff.
No, but here's the thing, though, why comedians should be well-read
right.
is that being well-read stimulates your brain.
I absolutely.
Mean, my wife would tell you who works.
Psychologist. Your wife's a psychiatrist.
But she's a neuropsychologist. Right. She studies the brain.
Right,
I mean,
right.
That there's a huge, huge fact in people that get Alzheimer's, don't get Alzheimer's or don't get dementia. Is because they find, you know, they are, you know, they're into crossword puzzles.
Wait, is that true? Stuff. I don't know that. So yes, there's a study where people who, like, you could stave off Alzheimer's. You won't get it, according to
I'm
stats.
I'm not saying you won't get it.
Right, I'm just saying, statistically.
You can slow it down.
It helps.
And 10 years ago, they said that there's a possibility this could happen. And within the last month, they said, absolutely, scientists have proven that. Keeping your brain, the biggest thing for people our age would be to learn another language. That was, they said that would.
Because that's so much concentration.
Right.
You use your brain so much. Well, you learn Japanese, you can't have Alzheimer's and learn Japanese.
But it also stimulates you to write in other ways. Even if you're, you know, I notice if I'm reading a book,
right,
it makes me, yeah, it makes your mind kind of
well,
go.
People always say, well, people are surprised because, you know, I'm so uneducated, but they say, oh, God, you know a lot about a lot of stuff. I'm like, no, I don't. I just watch, I love documentaries and shit. I just watch them like I watch anything else. And then I have knowledge about it. So if someone brings up something, I talk about it because I just saw it. Like, you know, Watergate. Or something like, you know, I know a lot about it because I've watched 15 documentaries on it. So if the Watergate comes up in discussion and I spew out something that is kind of obvious. You know.
So you would have left the Boy Scout camp to watch the Watergate hearings is what you're saying then.
Well, yeah, Dan, that's why are we bringing that up? Dan was in Boy Scout camp and he left camp because he wanted to watch the Watergate hearings at 11 years old.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah. Nice.
There's no way to... There's no way to break that down. Tell your wife that.
My son gets up. My son's, you know, not even nine yet, but he does like to get up early and watch the news.
Good for him.
He'll get into it.
Maybe he'll write some bitch.
But then he starts. Dad, no. But then he starts asking fucking crazy deep questions that are so fucking
like who's running for president
for eight.
What's he say?
Well, this must come up in schools now. Transgenders. That's a
big subject.
That question comes up
sure
almost every third night when I'm putting them to sleep. He's like, where do they go to the bathroom?
Oh, well, that's a good... You know what? Does he say that, really?
He's asked that. Where do they go to the which
dude,
bathroom?
Dude, that's really impressive. It is. I would think that's a kid who really is curious about his stuff.
And
yeah.
He actually said, he goes, Dad, if I don't ever let me... be an idiot and try smoking. Don't, because I'm afraid I won't be able to, you know, that's an addictive, right? How fast can you get addicted?
You're
he loves asking
me.
That. How fast does addiction happen?
Is that, like, was it a coincidence that he, right after meeting me, he asked that question? No. Why is Uncle Artie so crazy? Well, dude, that's amazing, especially the bathroom issue. Do you know the details on that, by the way? Like you know, this is why I don't like when Springsteen gets a little too political. I'm like, you know, sing Backstreets, right? Get the fuck out of here.
Have
you know what the details are on that bathroom thing, the transgender? What they're asking, transgender people are asking people to tolerate?
What?
Okay. Basically, they're saying, and Dan, I don't know, you know, Dan usually points out when I'm wrong. What I can tell is if a grown man, me or you, without any sort of, you know, identification or a document on us that proves this doctor letter from a doctor or something, nothing that proves it. If we in our head say, I relate in my head to being a woman more than I even though I was born with a cock and balls and I'm a man, mm-hmm. I relate in my head more the way Bruce Jenner said he did to being a woman because I think that in my head, I could use this later on in front of a judge as a legal argument where I could get off because of it. I can walk into a girl's room, a ladies' room, and take a leak.
Mm-hmm.
Sit down and take a shit. And if a woman walks in with her 4-year-old daughter or an 11-year-old girl walks in by herself and is in the stall next to me and I'm out of toilet paper, and I go, hey, can I have some toilet paper? And that girl starts to burst into tears as she would, runs out and gets a cop. The cop can't arrest me because I go, I identify as being a woman. That's what they want. And call me not sensitive. There's no way I want that to be the case. That can't happen.
Dan, your thoughts? Dan's Mr. Liberal, so what do you like about that?
I'm not
that. Am I wrong or right?
You're pretty much right.
But is that what the law says? See, I originally thought they wanted a third bathroom. That was going
to
say.
Like, no. They want to be able to go in because they said they have been.
Who would be for that? Yeah. So anybody could just go, I'm a child molester. Anybody could go, I feel like a woman today. I'm going into the ladies' room. Right?
This is one of the things I'm not liberal in.
And that's why Springsteen wouldn't do a concert in North Carolina. Come on, dude.
Have you seen
this? Be a little bit of a man. I mean, Joe, are you comfortable with that? Would you allow that? Would you be for a law?
I agree with you because someone could take advantage and
yeah. Even if they don't want to take advantage, I don't care. I don't want. Say I feel like a chick one day. You want me taking a leak next to your daughter?
No.
Have you seen this guy, the liberal redneck?
Someone
showed it to me yesterday.
Take a bit. I gotta take a diabetic piss.
Is that a fake guy, Dan?
That's a bit, right?
I don't know.
He plays it like it's a real guy. He doesn't play it as he's doing a character. And he makes these videos and puts them out there. And he's not trying to be comedic. He talks a lot about transgender and how why are you Republicans giving them shit, that you're uncomfortable with them, they're uncomfortable. Like, that's like a lot of the video fodder is about that.
I'll look it up. I'll have to watch it.
I'll look it up.
Why don't you give your plugs while
diabetic piss is going on?
Yeah.
What do you think's the best thing to plug on the Artie Quitter podcast? Your own podcast or a gig? Does anyone really come to the gigs when you plug? I find that
yes, they do.
When I plug a gig, are they really going to come to it when I'm on someone else's podcast? I always think that maybe plugging your own podcast is probably the proper plug. Then you're going to go to Artie's gig if he promotes a gig, but I don't know if you're going to come to mine. I don't know. That's my negative thing. But I base it on what I've seen. People are going, well, you suck at comedy. That's why we're not coming to your shows. That's Artie. Artie's fans would say that. Even if they were fucking around, they would just say that. I was going to plug because the guy who owns it is a friend of Artie. So I was going to wait till Artie came back to plug it.
Well, then plug your podcast. July 7th.
But I'll plug my podcast. Go to joematteris.com or iTunes or Stitcher wherever you listen to podcasts. It's called Fixed Joe. I'm semi-fixed and not fixing anymore, but Fixed Joe, that's the podcast. And I have callers call in, and I let them call in, and I answer their questions or talk about whatever they left a voicemail idea on it, and that number is 914-246-0238 if you ever wanted to call in and leave messages, and it's cool. And my Twitter's at the Joe Matteris.
Nice.
I was gonna plug a gig, but
you knew
the owner. I'm doing Sil Bazile's place in Diamond Beach, Wildwood. I never know if it's called Wildwood or Diamond Beach.
It's right next to it's technically Diamond Beach is a part of Wildwood, I mean.
It is.
That's
okay.
Great.
July 7th, we're doing a gig down there. Me and this guy Joe Conklin, who's like this Philly celeb that
I did it a couple
of
years
in.
Ago. I did an appearance there at the same thing you're doing at Chattanooga.
Oh, you did? I think it's a tented in
on the beach.
Thing.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
And Sil's a great guy.
July 7th. JoeMatteris.com if you want to come out to that. In Wildwood.
If I'm around, maybe I'll come down there.
4th of July week. I was going to ask you how you doing without the Shore House now, and now that it's summer
months. I just sold it. The last couple of years, I wasn't down there as much. But, I had it 10 years. I do miss it a little bit. I'm thinking I don't have that anymore. That was like a fun sanctuary to go down and relax. But it was just the right time in life to get rid of it. So it's not that bad.
And you have the kind of money that if you wanted to go down for a weekend, you could just go rent a place.
Well,
it's a lot easier.
I might rent the place for the summer next year. Just rent the big place. Because it's a lot. Owning a place is a big hassle, especially in the winter down there. So, that's great. Well, the Sil thing is awesome. And
what's your favorite Jersey Shore place you would get a place? Where would you do that?
Well,
do you have a spot picked out?
Where I was great. I loved right on the bay of Tom's River. It was like a little sanctuary. You were down at that house, right?
Yeah, nice house.
Yeah, that's right, early on.
Do you remember you left me in the ocean? You don't remember. You probably
I thought I said, no, we were on my jet skis. I bought jet skis, and I love those fucking things. And me and you were jet skiing, and we went out by the ocean. We went further than people tell you to go. The guy who sold me the jet ski said, "Yeah, Art, yeah, I know you. You know, I know you're a little bit crazy. I'm a fan. I know you like taking stupid risks, but don't go past that bridge." Joe and I went way past. And I came back alone, and Joe's lovely wife was there, and Pete Dominic was there with his lovely wife.
Yeah.
And Adrian was there. That's right. That was like that summer.
Yeah.
And I said to everybody, I said, listen, I don't know if I'm ever going to see Joe Matarese.
He thought I died.
No. And then
I was following you back.
I lost you. I said, I don't know where Joe is.
You were ahead of me and never turned around.
Well, what do you want me to know?
I took on seaweed, and I didn't know you have to jam your hand inside the
By the way, I didn't know that either.
And rip it out if it... when a jet ski clogs, they don't.
I purposely didn't tell you as a joke.
It's hilarious. I was stuck out there for like an hour and a half, getting no sunblock on. Just getting fried.
So you were in trouble.
Yeah. then I flagged somebody, and they came over and they shoved their hands inside and ripped all the seaweed out. And then I came back like an hour and a half later.
Jersey people, hey, jerk off, you got seaweed in there.
Artie was eating a supersod and mozzarella fucking hoagie,
which is why I'm
in the ocean.
I'm trying to make it realistic. That was fun.
There's nothing better than when you have a pool that's on the bay. There was nothing better than that.
That was perfect. That was a great spot, man. Very tranquil.
Your mom decorated the whole thing.
That cost me a fucking arm and a leg. It was a little project. I said, Mom, you decorate. It'd be fun, you know. Something you could do. I'll pay for you. I found that if something's cute, $10,000. If something's adorable, $15,000. If something is out of this world, I got to do like 4 gigs that weekend. I got to do a theater if something's out of this world.
And I have the wife that likes to go to bed at like 10, even though we're like at the Jersey Shore on the weekend. Artie has insomnia, and he's playing pool at 5 a.m. We hear like, someone's shooting pool?
Huh?
He's playing 9-ball against himself at 5 a.m.
A lot of hookers don't go to bed at 10. Your wife loved that house.
She did like it. Oh. Very nice.
Oh. Well, thanks for coming over. thanks for coming. The great Joe Matarese. Check him out. I may come July 7th, Diamond Beach. Good luck with the meetings.
Thank you, man.
And now,
That must sound great on the podcast.
People complain. I'm like, what do I mean? It's a quarter a day. Fuck off. Dan, why don't we go off from the beginning, just play the whole thing. Play the whole what's going on. What's
that? Okay.
All right. We'll end with what's going on. And Dan, of course, you know how Eddie Van Halen did a guest guitar on Beat It by Michael Jackson? This is Dan doing his version of that. He went to the studio with the four non-blondes, and he did a quick solo in between. Like he's a rap artist. Like he does a quick rap in between the song. All right.
Like Michael McDonald used to in other people's songs.
Christopher Cross.
Exactly. That's exactly what I was thinking of. So here's what's going on by John Dempsey.
Yes.
Got to give him props. Great song parody.
He's got another one coming tomorrow, he told me.
Oh, that's fucking amazing. Keep him coming, Dempsey. Later.
Of this brotherhood of man. whatever that means, into a crisis.
I'm a fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag. Fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag. I'm a fucking fag.
My life is still trying to get up that great big hill of hope.